closest one she has. So I take back what I said about her, although she doesn't always hoist. Wonderful golden light. Oh, there we go. Isn't that wonderful? Beautiful leopard silhouette. I am going to go a little bit forward just to see where she settles. Go. Look at that, everyone. Isn't that wonderful? There we go. And I'll move forward as soon as that other vehicle stopped. Let's go a little bit forward. That doesn't seem to be a baby impala. It looks like a little steenbok. It's a bit of the dust. It's a fairly grim picture of its face. You tell me when you have a shot. Seat at this speak very quietly because I'm actually speaking into the ear of the back seat of this vehicle in front of us, and it's slightly embarrassing. As per your comment earlier, Valerie, you were saying you wonder if any of the guides feel a little bit silly talking basically to themselves when there are other guests around on safari. Yes. Certainly, sometimes we do feel rather silly.
Look at it.
There we go. fairly grim, Andrew.
It looks like a baby impala to me.
Is it?
In the expert.
Oh, no, it is. Sorry, it is. Mm. It is beautiful. Yeah, everyone, that is a baby impala. Sorry. It's a bit embarrassing. Yeah, it is. Right, so, Sammy, you wanted to know how high a leopard can jump. Sammy, I've seen them picking sort of a guinea fowl out of the air and leaping up to 6 or 7 feet off the ground, so I mean they can jump very high, probably much higher than that too if they really wanted to. And Paul Rizzo, you were saying that the leopards look like they climb so effortlessly. They do climb effortlessly. They don't often descend trees very effortlessly. They can be very kind of slippery and slidey on their way down, but yes, they certainly go up total effortlessness. So just if you are watching this for the first time, can be a very grim sort of sight for you to look at, but you know, leopard's got to eat, and it's really just very special to see them in this kind of situation. It's a quintessential African shot. Trisha, you want to know in pounds per square inch what the bite force of a leopard is, and I'm afraid I don't know offhand. It's pretty powerful. It's not as powerful as a hyena's. It's not as powerful as the jaguar's. Probably roughly the same as a lion's, but no, I couldn't tell you for sure, I'm afraid, what the bite force of a leopard was, but we can have a look. Maybe somebody kind in the final control would check it up for us, but I don't know exactly what the pounds per square inch is. Just amazing to watch this in the golden light with a storm sort of brewing behind us. Very lucky indeed. Very good question, of course, that is not often asked, but is sort of implicit in what we do. Lions, do lions ever climb trees? Janet, yes, they do. They are very inelegant descenders of trees. They're quite elegant on the way up. They don't often do it, but they will climb. And there's a reserve in East Africa called Lake Manyara, where the lions are famed for climbing the trees, and that's supposedly to stay out of the way of the flies. So yes, they absolutely do climb trees, and they will also climb trees to scavenge from other predators. So You know, if she hid this not too far from the ground in a branch that a lion felt it could balance on, the lion would definitely try and steal this kill. It is a baby impala, and I tell you what confused me when we originally drove in here was the fact that it's, I think its nose has been crushed. I think that's how it was killed, which is not a normal sort of killing by for a baby impala, but it did make the face look a little more squat, and that's why I mistook it. So there we go, very kind from Kirsten in Final Control. 310 psi is the bite force of a leopard. I think a hyena is around 800 psi, so that's pretty huge. A hyena is actually 1,100 psi. So, I mean, you read different things about them, but at least three times the power in a leopard's bite.
Tree, with the magical afternoon light that's bathing down on us, I must say I am quite jealous. So enjoy that, and we're going to keep searching for you.
Weather coming in, do they know? Are they reliable indicators? Brian, I would say almost universally not very good indicators in this area. I haven't seen any change or obvious change in animal behavior. Save for that, you know, if there's a big wind coming in, animals will start to hide, but that's, you know, we would do the same thing. I don't think that they have necessarily a sense of barometric pressure. I think birds perhaps do, and I think frogs perhaps do. I don't believe the mammals behave very differently. And if they're expecting a storm, when the storm hits, then yes, obviously. I think we're just going to stay right here, if that's all right with you. Isn't that wonderful to see everyone? I'll try and get a slightly better angle. Andrew's twisted himself into the most incredible position to try and bring in this shot. Yeah, if that's all right with you. Isn't that wonderful to see everyone? I'll try and get a slightly better angle. Andrew's twisted himself into the most incredible position to try and bring in this shot. Ellen, thank you very much for your information, one of our resident leopard fundies. Ellen, you say that she was called Tingana when she was first born. Now, Tingana, of course, is already a male leopard around here called Tingana, same age as her, actually. And then when she took a territory on Arathusa, she became Shadow. So thank you very much for that. And Jeffrey, you reckon that's because she's so hard to track. Jeffrey, I think all leopards are hard to track. Shadow is just a brilliant name for a leopard. Look at the colour on that. That's perfect, Andrew. Silent while this other vehicle comes behind us. Oh, this is wonderful. An odd spit of rain coming down, but I mean, as you can see, there's blue sky above us. So I think it's just blowing in off the front of that storm. Now, very difficult, of course, to balance the leopard on the tree, a kill on the tree. So, interesting question from Shell, and I think it's a very important one to address. Thank you, Shell. She gave us a little growl, or she bared her teeth at us earlier. You want to know, if we hadn't moved, would she have become more aggressive? No, I don't believe so. I think she would have moved. She wasn't cornered, so, you know, if you corner a leopard, that's a different story, but she could just easily have moved away, and a leopard will not choose to engage physically if she can. She'll say, go away, and if you don't, then normally she'll go away. The reason I moved was not because I felt like there was going to be an escalation of the situation where she might actually charge. It was simply because she was saying, you're making me uncomfortable, please move away. And you know, we have to oblige when that happens. The last thing you want to do is break the trust of these animals. So, Shell, very good question. Just about all animals here will move away rather than engage in some sort of physical contest. Olive and Emma, you're just 5 years old and you've asked a question, is she bad because she doesn't have any cubs? Olive and Emma, is she sad that she doesn't have any cubs? Olive and Emma, I think she was sad, you know, when she lost her cubs. There are lots of animals out here that do seem to. It's difficult for us to tell if they're sad or not, of course, because they can't speak and they don't cry, obviously, and they, you know, their faces are not like ours, where you can tell if by looking at your friend if she's sad or not. Same isn't the same for animals, but I think definitely animals do feel sad when they have loss. We know that elephants feel sad. You've seen when your dog or your cat is happy or sad, and so I'm sure she was very sad when she lost her cubs. And hopefully she will have some more. She was mating earlier, so maybe she's pregnant and she will have another cub. Eric, we've sort of chatted about this, but not really. Like I say, she had a cub, and he was a year old when he went off unfortunately into rehab after being exposed to rabies. He's so far fine as far as we know, but we don't really know. Other than that, we don't know what's happening with him. And Eric, that was the longest that a cub has stayed with her. Normally, they will go independent around 18 months to 2 years. In the case of female cubs, 8 months is the oldest, is the youngest that a cub has ever become independent, which is really impressive. I mean, 8 months is a little leopard, and incredible that a female should have become independent at that age. And quite interesting also, is that the males take a bit longer. It's quite astonishing that the males, well, I mean, a bit like human beings, take a bit longer to grow up. I'm just going to quickly ask about whether we can stay here for other people coming to the site or not, because I can't actually hear what's going on the radio, and we may need to make some space. But we didn't find her, so we might have to leave and make some space for other game drives. Station's really struggling. The radio station's trying to get into the side of the strip. Sorry everybody, I will get back to your questions now. I'm just trying desperately to find out what's going on here. Are there any stations still standing by for this site? In the airstrip, I can make space. Okay, cover that. Somewhere when you get close, in a minute out, I will get out. Sorry everybody, we're going to have probably another 10 minutes with this leopard. And then we're going to have to move out. Oh, I was trying to get in here, I'm afraid. Sorry Andrew, I was getting a better position over your Emmy award winning shot. How's that? And look at the rainbow, look at that everybody. Isn't that fantastic? Look at that, a rainbow and leopard all in one. That's just stunning. Oh wow. Oh, it really doesn't get much better than that, everyone. Isn't that spectacular? Captured in the glorious golden light. Just beautiful. Pamela, a very nice question from you on Twitter. You want to know if a kill has ever fallen? fallen into a vehicle. Not as far as I'm aware, Pamela. I've never had a kill in the vehicle. I think you'd have to be driving pretty badly and giving your guests a real crick in their necks, yeah, if you were to park underneath the kill. I think actually I have had a bit of kill fall onto the bonnet before as I was driving underneath one. So yes, it is possible. Ah, yeah.
Hi guys.
Hello. Kwala.
Swati,
I'm sorry. I'm full of echo. Saying hello to the other guides. It's important, of course, that we maintain a relationship with people. And like I say, we are going to have to pull out in about 5 or 10 minutes. Fascinating question here that I haven't really thought about too much, Rich. Rich King, you want to know if the cats here like house cats might bury their feces? Rich, they don't really, you know. Certainly none of the big ones. I suspect maybe the caracal and serval do, but the big cats, no, not so much. And I think it's mainly because they're very effective territorial markers. You know, often cats will bury, or animals will bury, dung in order to hide their presence, but the dung from these cats definitely helps them to mark their territories. While we're watching the leopard in the tree, a few days ago I climbed a tree and showed you the traditional use of the leopard orchid, which is to chew the cane or the stick that the leaf comes on and say the name of the one you want, and she'll immediately start thinking of you. And Dr. Debbie, you want to know if I've heard from Scarlett Johansson yet? Debbie, I haven't. I think maybe it was because it wasn't during the full moon or 12 o'clock at night. We'll see. I'll try again on the full moon.
You there? John? Long story, but I want to say Tangra Mobile.
Eileen, you want to know why dead animals always have their eyes open? They don't always, but certainly sometimes they do. And I think it's mainly because when they die, that they're, you know, they aren't sort of asleep, if you know what I mean. So if they get killed and their eyes are shut, then they stay shut. But normally that animal is fighting for its life. When it dies, and that's why the eyes are so open. Are they close by? Okay, I'm going to pull out. Okay. Okay. All right, we're going to have to leave, everybody. There is another vehicle coming in. Isn't that beautiful? All right, everyone, say goodbye to Shadow. Wonderful sighting we've had of her. And we'll see her hopefully later. Marvelous. Now home. Okay, inkomo. Itabona ana sikrumo. Wow. What a wonderful sighting that was. I think let's drive along the airstrip and get a look at the storm. I think it's dissipating, you know. I don't think it's going to... No, it's not. It's a monster. That's a big chap. Andrew, do you like the smell in the air now? The aroma of decaying impala flesh.
Mixed with rain. Yeah,
mixed
yeah.
with rain. It really is very nice. And in Texas, there is a question of yours coming through. I think it was read to me, then half deleted by somebody, and then I didn't hear it, but here it comes. Right, and fear not, here is your question. You want to know if leopards have their favorite trees or if they'll just use any tree that they can. And they don't really have a favorite. They're normally in marula trees. I think that's a function of the fact, though, that marula trees are good climbing trees. But if there are lots of jackalberries around, they'll happily climb those. They like, in some areas where there are mahogany trees, they'll climb those because they're good to sit in. So it's just got to do with the shape of the tree. Anything that's kind of decently shaped that they can climb up and hang something in, they will climb. I've seen them in knobthorn trees even, and I mean a knobthorn is a profoundly thorny and uncomfortable thing to be in. And it raises an interesting subject of whether or not leopards are in fact arboreal. Do they live in trees? They don't, you know. They're largely terrestrial. If they can avoid being in trees, they will. It's uncomfortable for them in trees. And so, yeah, you just don't often find them sitting in trees. But if they are trying to hoist and stow their kills away from scavengers. Right, let's head across to Scott and we'll see what he's got to show you. I think we'll probably head back towards Djuma now and see you there.
Very happy you have been spending some quality time with Shadow and James. Isn't it a beautiful evening? The rainbow, the dark clouds, some magical sunlight coming through. We are now approaching a very picturesque part of Djuma, the major riverbed that flows through called the Mulwati. And we should get some views of some beautiful big trees in that area. Now, two beautiful things that we will not be looking at this afternoon are springbuck and gemsbuck. And Anne was interested to know if we got those two antelope here. We don't get them in the Sabi Sands, neither in the entire Kruger National Park. They prefer drier, more arid areas, typically around the central and western parts of South Africa. So sadly, not here. You do get eland, another very nice antelope, the largest of all the African antelopes, but they occur further north in the Kruger National Park, so we don't get them here in the Sabi Sands. I'm very, very happy. happy to hear that Gracie has shared her Santa list with us, a Santa safari wish list. And high up on her list are, most importantly, rain and food for all of the animals, and that's very kind and thoughtful of you, Gracie. She would also like sweets and toys for all of the Wild Earth Safari crew. That's us. Very important. Thank you, Gracie, that you're looking after the animals as well as us. And then for you, last on the list, a safari Barbie. And that is a great idea. I hope we can find you one. I'm not sure if Barbie likes coming on safari, but I'm sure Santa will be able to try and find you a safari Barbie. I don't know if we're going to be able to get to this, but we'll have a try high up. Hey, up, Brian's well on it. High up in this Ledwood tree, there is a woodland's kingfisher letting off its shrill call. Let's see if it doesn't do it again. I'm sure there were two perched up there just a moment ago. It may have flown off its partner. They do form monogamous bonds. Gracie, I'm very happy you've shared your very thoughtful Santa list with us. And I need to get mine written down soon. And as soon as I've worked out what it is I think I should ask for, I will be sure to let you know. But I think I might actually just copy yours, because your list is very nice, that you're thinking about the animals first, then other people, and yourself last. And if the rest of the world thought like that, we'd be in a very good place. So thank you, Gracie, for teaching us all a very good lesson there when writing a wish list. Discussing a lot of birds' nesting habits and nest sites, and how desperate we are to try and follow the life of some chicks that are growing up. And Jacqueline has just asked me if I've ever seen a chick fledge for the first time, actually take flight for the first time. And I haven't, Jacqueline. I've never been able to monitor a bird's nest that closely. But with our current plans and intentions and the place we are, maybe we can all share a wonderful, wonderful experience like that. And we are all searching desperately for the perfect nest. I've even built that one nest that I'm hoping is going to allow us easy monitoring. Good. Well, it sounds like James has got up on some high ground and has got a wonderful view of the setting sun out to the west.
Well, we just thought we had to show you this incredible storm that's brewing over to the west. It's not brewing, it's broken. It is now dumping its load on the Bushbuck Ridge area. Huge storm going on there. You can see the water pouring out of the sky. Isn't that a wonderful view? And you can also see how isolated it is. So, I mean, that's an area probably about 30 kilometers, 40 kilometers long that's getting that rain. If that, actually. And it would be very nice to have that here, I must say. I don't know that it's going to reach us. The big black clouds are all around here. I'm sure they're going on, you know, in various parts, but just not over us at the moment. But maybe later. That is just stunning. Thank you very much, Chantel, for your kind words. Oh, look at that lighting. Did you see it, Andrew?
Yeah.
Good job. Well done. Chantel, you say you love that sighting and you were very grateful for it. Thank you. It's very easy, of course, to to entertain people when you have a magnificent leopard like that, and you say, what's my favorite big cat to spend time with? Well, unquestionably a leopard. Young males especially, because they're so inquisitive, they're always moving around, and if you can find one on foot, that's just really, really special. But any leopard, Chantel, that would be my favorite big cat to spend time with. Thank you for watching. That is astonishing lightning. Huge storms, of course, up on the Highveld, which is basically, the Highveld means highlands, and that's where Johannesburg is, and where I grew up, and where Andrew grew up, and we used to get storms there, what, Andrew, in the summer, almost every afternoon.
Correct.
Huge thunderheads would come rolling in, and massive electrical storms there. So if you happen to be from Johannesburg, and these storms do come through, it really is it's a profoundly wonderful feeling. It's almost a homely feeling when you see the big storms coming. I remember I lived in Cape Town for 2 years. Look at the lightning going there. I lived in Cape Town for 2 years, and the rain there tends not to storm like this. It comes in sort of fronts. And I remember once we had a huge storm there one night, and there was lightning and thunder, and I got out of bed and went outside and just reveled in it, because it was just such a tremendously powerful reminder of childhood, I suppose. So I just love the storms when they come through. All right, well, that's the rain. Let's see if we can't spot something with a heartbeat. Are you getting a lot of static? Not. I've got entirely static. Oh, it's the Game Guy radio. Okay, right, got you now. Jose? You're in Virginia, I think I heard correctly, and you would like to know how many languages I speak and what language I was speaking just now. I was speaking a language called Shangaan or Xitsonga. You can use them sort of interchangeably in this area. I don't speak it particularly.
No mammals that I can think of, and thankfully no reptiles have jumped on board either. I have heard a few horror stories of people off-roading and snakes getting bumped off trees into a moving vehicle, usually in a predator sighting. So imagine following a pride of lion and then a boom slung or another venomous snake falls into your vehicle. Where do you go? Into the lion or on the vehicle with the snake? I guess you can do the maths and work out your own calculations there. But no, nothing serious, Rich King. I've heard of another horror story of a giraffe falling into a vehicle that was being brought down by lions. And if I remember that story correctly, I think it may have even been a fatal fall onto the vehicle and some people lost their lives. So you do hear the occasional horror story, but I guess that is the planet we live on. You get these kind of freak disasters that happen from time to time. But usually the animals stay away from us here. I know in certain parts of Masai Mara there in the Serengeti or various reserves where you see cheetah, they will use the vehicles as vantage points. And obviously that is something that would be very fun, but I'm on the kind of outlook that it should be prevented and you should disallow animals from the vehicle. That's not likely to attack us as a human. You're just allowing them to kind of overstep human-animal boundary. Evening, James. Go ahead. James was looking for me on the radio, but now as I tried to contact him, no response. Oh well, I'm sure it's nothing urgent and he's probably just wanting to know where I'm working. The two roads that I haven't driven yet on Djuma are Aubrey's Road and Hyena Road. Other than that, I've basically done everything. Okay, well, very good. Now that he knows where we are and what my plans are, he is going to update you on his plans, and I think that is to possibly head to the hyena den. Good stuff. See you later.
Well, we are back, everybody, and Scott Dyson, being psychic, has predicted correctly. We're going to try and see if we can find something at the hyena den. I think it's going to be particularly interesting to see what this virtual reality rig is able to pick up in a place like the hyena den. So that's where we're going at the moment. Very nice to see old HT on safari. He heads back, unfortunately, to the UK tomorrow. It really has just been a wonderful experience having him around here and having the old hands to teach us their tricks. A really important part of guiding, the whole guiding experience, is having mentors. Too far away, Andrew, if you wouldn't mind pointing your camera at the eastern horizon there. Just get an idea of the kind of cloud that seems to have left a vortex of clarity above us, but it's dumping its rain everywhere else in the Kruger Park. And we just went past Taxon, and who was driving Hayden, and he says that his house in Acorn Hook, which is where that storm was blowing down, has done some serious damage to his house. No hail, thankfully, but lots of wind. And I suspect, given the state of some of the roofing in that area, I suspect it's probably pulled the roof off his house. And, you know, lots of people there to help, so it'll be okay. And obviously a very, very big storm they had out in Acorn Hook. Going past quarantine clearings now. Janice, you want me to find your cheetah because Hayden saw one? I'll do my best, Janice. Give me 3 minutes. Go and check out a Wahlberg's Eagle with Scott, and we'll show you a cheetah when you get back.
So, here we have a Wahlberg's Eagle. We are very close to it, and I think this is possibly the closest I've ever been to one with all of you. This is a pale form, so it's slightly lighter than normal, but they are usually a kind of a chocolatey brown color. Interestingly, the pair that nest in this area are both pale. Look at its long talons there on the branch it's perched on. Great view of those. Well, I'm glad Janet jumped at the opportunity to figure out that Brent is in fact the answer to Rich King's question a bit earlier, the largest animal to jump into this vehicle. And I think you're right, it'll be a close tie between Brent and Brian, though. They are two of the larger individuals on our crew. Okay, well, we're going to send you back to James. I hope you enjoyed that little view of the Wahlbergs.
Well, I was just reminiscing with my old pal Andrew here about the amazing sighting we had during Big Cat Week of Mpula. Very lucky. We were on our way to the hyena den. Saw three hyenas on the road, and we're just sitting there marveling at the sight, and then 3 minutes later looked up and there was Mpula in the tree trying to escape the hyenas. It doesn't often happen like that, but what an amazing privilege when it does, especially during Big Cat Week. And the ultimate objective, of course, is to find Andrew.
Big cats.
Yes, big cats. Janet, I'm very sorry, we didn't find a cheetah.
Like, without being facetious, this is really not ideal cheetah habitat. It is woodland area, and cheetahs do prefer more open areas where they can course, they can run fast after their prey. Here, it's not easy, and I remember an incident at Londolozi once where a cheetah actually disemboweled itself. It was running so fast, you know, they go at such a speed, and it jumped over a fallen log or something that an elephant had pushed over, and that cut out the cheetah's belly, and it actually disemboweled itself. So that's generally why they don't like this area too much. So not a very nice story. I think they actually managed to, it's happened twice, I think they managed to save one of the cheetahs. Ooh. Eric, very good question. We're chatting about cheetahs and you want to know why it is that the... Oh, look who's here. Eric, I'll get back to your question. We have what's known as a girl power safari going on here. Look at that. Hello, Jamie. Look at that.
Hello, James.
Oh, hello, Jamie. Don't go past without saying hello. You know, everybody does love you.
Hello, everybody. This is Emma. Emma's wonderful.
How's it going? Hello, Emma. Emma's wonderful. There we go.
Emma is wonderful.
That's good news. It's always important to go on safari with wonderful people. I find.
I feel the same way.
Not idiots. You don't want to go with them.
No, try to.
Right. As you were. All which right. Side is best, do you think?
Right.
Normal side.
Yep, normal okay. Side. Enjoy.
Enjoy your drive.
Thank you.
Enjoy.
Cheers.
See you just now. We can't move. So that was Jamie. Such a privilege, I tell you what, having a lady on the staff, on the team. And as I said yesterday, oh, the cub's out. I didn't say that yesterday. As I said yesterday, the real advantage to having ladies on guiding and ranging teams is that their egos tend to be so much smaller than the men. And that means that they don't push animals too hard. They don't act in a macho fashion after the push, which is wonderful. They teach us all a lesson every day. Exactly, they're not cowboys. Well, I did see the cub. Andrew, where'd it go? Let's just stop here for a little while. I hope that it's just gone the other side there. We will go across there if the little thing doesn't move up here. I saw it leaping about on the top of the mound. Anyway, while we're doing that, I'll just ask that question about the cheetahs and why it is they've got that white mantle on the back of the cheetah cubs, why they've got that white mantle on their backs. That's Andrew turning on the VR rig. Thank you, Andrew. And the reason they have that white mantle, we think, everybody, is that they look a little bit like honey badgers when they're little, and I think maybe it just puts off predators slightly. Predators don't like honey badgers. Honey badgers are voracious defenders of themselves and their cubs. And I think that that white mantle perhaps makes them look a little bit like honey badgers. And that could be why they are colored like that. I also think it makes it easier for them to lie down in the grass and hide if they're threatened. I'm going to sit here for another 2 minutes. Oh, there's the six-month-old cub. There, you can see her back. I think the little one is probably with her. Let's sit here for another 2 minutes, and then we'll move around that side and see if we can't see the black cub. Jamie was sitting right where we are, and she said the cub was around here. Dr. Debbie, we've heard these hyenas going, heard the little one going, and you want to know what the strangest noise that I've heard an animal make is. Dr. Debbie, I think that the most bizarre noise that I've heard probably comes from a hippo. Hippos make the most astonishing noises when they're threatened or when they're trying to mate. They've got this kind of, I'm not going to do it here because it will create great consternation at the den, but this kind of loud, groaning noise sounds like it comes from another world entirely. Yeah. No, it's not. It's the nose. So Dr. Dibby, I'd say hippos are probably the ones that make the most strange noise for me. What about you, Andrew?
An ostrich makes a very strange noise.
An ostrich does make an odd noise, yes.
Or a bird.
Yes. It's almost like a roar. I think we're going to go around the other side there and see if this one can get a slightly better look at the cub. If we can't, we'll just come straight back to this area and wait patiently. I'm in two minds. See what the mother does. It's the most perfect den site, this. Lots of shade, huge termite mound for safety. Yeah, let's go on the other side down. Right, watch your head, Andrew. Wish to knock it off. So excited when I saw the baby, I thought we were in for a long sighting of her. Maybe we will be the other side. Rich King, why are we repositioning here? Now, you wanted to know by the sleep like a dog does. Rich, I haven't. I've no doubt they dream. Sorry, you lost me there. Rich King, a wonderful question. Have I ever seen hyenas running in their sleep like dogs? Rich, I haven't. I've no doubt they do dream, though, in much the same way that dogs and cats do. Oh, look. There we go. There's the little one. Well, I don't know what's going on here. They will often have more than one entrance to the hole. So maybe she's got another little hole in there. Maybe she's just playing around. Look at the little thing, exploring the world. So sweet. Six-month-old will just be at the edge of suckling, stopping almost weaned, and so we'll start to have to move around a bit with the clan. But this little thing, we've got another 5 months or so of suckling. Oh, look at it. Too precious. And every single time I see her, she looks like she's just getting a little bit more sure-footed. The lessons of running around on this mound are helping to solidify the neural bonds in her nervous system, help to strengthen the muscles that she's going to need as an adult hyena. And every single time I see her, she ventures just a little bit further down the mound. Look at that. The mother going, The little one chewing there. So sweet. Just feel a change in the atmosphere. Now everything around us is starting to calm down. The birds of the day have stopped singing, and we're into the changing of the guard.
to keep you informed. We won't put a light on them, but I mean, these days it's been staying light to almost 7 o'clock, so we wouldn't need to anyway. But these little ones are just a little bit too small. We just don't want to have any effect on their possible survival through putting lights on them. So sweet. You can feel the atmosphere. It's such a lovely atmosphere now. The cicadas are still going. And it just feels like the earth has taken a sigh and breathed out. Hyenas will move their dens every so often. These ones haven't moved now for probably 5 weeks. And the whole clan, I think, will make the decision to move when the time comes. This little one was actually born in here. And we don't know if this, how many cubs this mother has had and, you know, how long they will be in this den. So I don't know. You know, I would say if they are going to move, it'll be pretty soon. They will need to avoid the disease that comes along. But it won't be just that mother that decides where to move the den, because obviously the mother of the six-month-old cub will have a vested interest in where they go and where they stay, depending on who the matriarch is. We think maybe the mother of the six-month-old is the matriarch, although Brent said he didn't think so the other day. He saw she's got a big scar on her back, so she's easily identifiable. He thought maybe, or he thought he'd seen her being dominated by one or two others. And interestingly, just talking about first-time mothers, which I think this one's a little bit old to be a first-time mother, but first-time mother hyenas, 18% of them will die in childbirth because of that very odd arrangement of genitalia that they have. And of those 18%, and the rest of them, a lot of the cubs will die as well. So although 18% of mothers die in childbirth, a higher proportion, I think it's almost 40% of cubs born to first-time mothers will die. And for those of you who don't know, they've got a really odd kind of birth tract. The uterus is in the same place as it would be in any other sort of similarly shaped animal. But the fetus has got to come out of a sort of telescopically inverted pseudo-penis or a large clitoris, which is just, you know, it makes for an extremely awkward birthing process. Now, Tammy, you're obviously looking at the two different colors and wondering when the spots come. They'll start pretty soon. You can see completely spotted at 6 months, that one there. Almost 7 months, I suppose, but she was spotted by 6 months. And so this little one will start to get spots the more and more time she spends outside. Already around the face, she's getting a little bit of spotting around the neck. Look, look, look how close she's coming. Isn't that wonderful? This is the first time she's been this close to the car on her own. The mother's watching quite carefully. It's so sweet. But you can there very clearly see the spotting, Tammy, starting on the neck. That's Andrew just turning on the VR rig. He's calling him back. Virginia, apparently a number of years ago you were watching safari, there was a wild dog cub called Teddy, a and you want to know if we've managed to keep up with Teddy. Jenny, I have certainly never heard of a hyena. Look, look, she's coming so close. Never heard of a hyena called Teddy. Once they get to adult, though, it's very difficult to follow the individuals. Look how close. This is fantastic. She's taking the little one on a little walk. Giving Andrew the hairy eyeball. Oh, this is fantastic. This is just so special. I think they'll go straight back up the other side. You can hear her calling. Ooh, she sat down to suckle there, just below the den. Right, I'm just going to reverse back a bit. Try and get a decent view in there. Wonderful stuff. This is incredible. So, I don't know what happened to Teddy, but Jenny, it's very difficult to tell. Teddy could well be still around. Difficult to tell with the adults. We don't spend nearly as much time with them as we do with the leopards and lions. So to pick individuals from the clan, and especially if Teddy was a male, you know, he wouldn't necessarily be in the same clan. Oh, cub's coming back this way. Thank you, Andrew. This is fantastic. I don't know where to look. Jeffrey, do you want to know what causes them to die the first time mothers, and is it blood loss? Jeffrey, I don't know what it is, you know. I think it's internal injury. The fetus has basically got to do a 90-degree turn internally and then come out of this ridiculously shaped organ that doesn't look like it was ever designed to birth something. And I think that the internal injuries that result, I couldn't tell you what those are. The leading causes of deaths for young hyena mothers. I'm actually just going to wait here for a little while. Monique, you've asked a very pertinent, brilliant question. Why, if it is so harmful to the hyenas, you know, why do they have that anatomy that makes it harmful to them? Well, Monique, I'm going to take it back to human beings. For many, many, many years, until the advent of medical science and advanced obstetrics, of course, one of the greatest dangers to a woman was giving birth. And that's because our hips are placed where they are. And that birthing canal goes between the hips as opposed to out the back of them, as happens with most other mammals. And that makes birthing much less dangerous for them. That is simply because we are bipedal, we walk upright, and it's one of the sacrifices we've made to being bipedal. The birth canal is very narrow, especially for our youngsters, which have enormous heads. So Monique, in the case of the hyena, and I've just read about this, they reckon that the reason they have this highly matriarchal social society where the females, in order to maintain the social structure that they have this enormous amount of androgen or various androgens, different kinds of male sex hormones that give them all these male sex characteristics. And one of the costs of that, of these strange male organs that they have, one of the costs involved is this dangerous birth process. And it obviously, evolutionary wise, it obviously hasn't affected their numbers sufficiently for there to be enough selective pressure for them to have a different design, or for nature to come up with a different design. And so, yeah, it's just one of the trade-offs that they have for maintaining this incredibly successful social structure that they have. Great question, Monique, thank you. And I'm more than happy if you wish to discuss stuff like that again, and if you've got any more questions on it, let's think it through together. Or to laugh nicely, and probably even after that, maybe only after a year. Rich King. You want to know the cub's learning to clean itself. Rich, it's interesting, you know, hyenas are not fastidious cleaners like the cats. So I don't think there's a huge amount of effort to put into personal hygiene. Look at this thing, it's getting so close now. It's only about, I'd say about 8 feet away from us. Look at that. So Rich, no, I don't think there's a huge amount of sort of hygiene training that goes into it. Look, 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 look. Oh dear.
Don't bite the camera.
Just kick my earpiece out, so I missed the last question, but it'll come through again. Yeah, the cub is noticing the little red lights on the top of that on the top of the virtual reality rig. It does look slightly alien. Andrew, I think we might have to do something about those lights. Look at that. Fascinated by it, and it's just very slightly different from the normal, you know. The adult isn't affected at all. This one looks like it wants to jump up and have a bite. It'd be an expensive meal. Debbie in New Jersey, you've just tuned in and you heard me waffling on about disease around the hyena den, and you'd want me to explain a bit more. What I mean, Debbie, is that because they're in the hole there, there will inevitably be a buildup of disease, just like there is in a wild dog den or a cat den. Because the cub will be basically going to the toilet inside the hole there sometimes, and because there's no sort of cleaning out of the den, she will eventually make it smelly and sort of attract diseases, and so that hole will eventually become it'll become an incubator of diseases because of the different kinds of nutrients that will be brought in there. Through, they'll probably drag bits and pieces of dead stuff down there, go to the loo down there, and that won't be very good for the health of the hyena baby. So that's why they'll move. Also, if they're threatened, so if lions come around here and they keep coming past the area, they will definitely look going inside now, because the adult has left. Or thinking about going inside, doesn't want to be outside if mum's not here. There the adults are. I think they're going off to forage, you know. Well, that's the 6-month-old, that's not the adult. They are still there. There we go. Wonderful question from Deborah in Johannesburg. In the lions, there's a lot of what we call cross-suckling, where lions will cross-suckle each other. And if the, you know, if a lioness dies, if there's another lioness of sufficient age or the right age and the right state of lactation, she will feed the other cubs. That does not happen with hyenas. They do not cross-suckle. They don't cross-suckle their cubs at all. And so if this mother was to die, I think it would probably be tickets for the little cub. James, very nice question, all the way from Oklahoma. Brilliant name that you have, possibly the best name in the world. James, you want to know about males in hyena society, and do they ever run the show? James, there is not more downtrodden in the world than the male of a hyena clan. He is smaller than the females, is dominated. Even males born to the matriarch will eventually end up at the bottom of the pecking order. None of them outrank females as adults. So they never run the pack at all. They never may play any part in administration or government. And I don't mean that entirely facetiously. They really play no leadership role in the clan at all. And interestingly, if they want a mate, they also have a hierarchy, a very definite hierarchy amongst the males. But if a male wants to mate, he will normally have to leave his natal clan and go to another clan. And if he does do that, if he is adopted by another clan, his status will be right at the very bottom rung. Now, what happens if you're born into a clan like this and you have a bit of status, interestingly, only 4% of hyena babies are born to males born in that clan. In other words, if you're a high-ranking male, you can maintain your status if you want, but the chances of your leaving a genetic legacy, actually breeding, are extremely slim indeed. But if you're prepared to sacrifice your social status and go to another clan, then you will be able to breed. Now, I don't know of another animal, any mammal, anywhere in the world where that happens. It's normally completely the opposite. It's the males of higher status that mate, and those that are of low status do not mate. And that goes from human beings to chimpanzees to squirrels to lions, I suspect to dolphins. Although I don't know that for sure, I expected just about every single other mammal that I can think of. So if you can tell me another society in where males of lower status are more likely to breed than those of higher status, I'd be fascinated. And in Texas, a lovely question. I really enjoy discussing these complex topics to which there are no obvious answers. You want to know, do I think evolution will ever improve the sort of birthing rate? And whether it's mechanically possible for them to maintain the important kind of this false male genitalia that they have and have a birthing canal that is less dangerous, I don't know. Were it mechanically possible, and were that mutation to suddenly occur, absolutely. Over time, we would find that those with safer birthing canals were selected for. I'm not sure that selective pressure exists, though. It's the same as with human beings. I'm not sure that human beings, well, especially with obstetrics now, there's certainly no disadvantage to having narrow hips anymore. I'm not sure that human beings would ever change. For hundreds of thousands of years, many women died giving birth because our hips are, our birthing canals between the hips. Great question. Thank you for that. You're all getting a couple of spits of rain now. So. Right, Chantel, you are just 12 years old and you're homeschooling. Wonderful. I hope you're enjoying this. What a great biology lesson, I suppose this must be. Live in Africa. Brilliant stuff. We're happy to give you whatever information you need and keep asking us questions. Everybody, we're going to have to pull out of the sighting. It's getting dark and it is starting to rain, and that VR rig on the front of the car is now going to become wet, so we're going to have to pull that off. All right, let's head across to Scott quickly. He'll say goodbye to you, and I'll see you in just a little while. Bye-bye, hyenas. Thank you for a wonderful afternoon.
Sounds like a wonderful sighting at the den. Good news. Brian and myself parked in a set spot and just listened for about 10 or 15 minutes whilst Brian attempted to capture some lightning bolts to the south, and we sadly didn't hear any alarm calls or signs from the bush which may have helped us to track down Karula or any leopards or anything interesting happening. Any predators really will be alarmed at, maybe even a python that may have caught an impala lamb. It does happen. So our silent moments of silence was fruitless, but we have now just started driving again and hoping that the spotlight may help unveil something interesting. There's some great news that I've heard over the radio waves. A female leopard called Inkanyeni, who I've never actually seen before. I've seen her two cubs from a previous litter, Shiluva and Makombo, on one or two occasions. Either way, this female leopard Inkanyeni has got two tiny cubs. They've been seen for the first time, I think, this afternoon. They may have been seen beforehand, but it's the first I've heard of it. And isn't that wonderful news? The catch is that Inkanyeni doesn't spend time on our property, but that could change, and who knows, maybe we'll get lucky and she'll bring her little cubs across to Djuma for a visit. We haven't had any good leopard cub sightings since I've arrived, which has been a year now, so it'll be really great if we can change that. But good to know that two new leopard cubs are in the Sabi Sands, and for now they're doing well. I must warn everyone in advance that even if we may not get attached to these two cubs in specific, we could well come across another two cubs, maybe the cubs of Shadow or Karula in the future. But sadly, the mortality rate with leopard cubs and lion cubs is very high. So it's important to remember that the odds are stacked against them. And as cute and adorable as they are, it's important to try to remember to not get too attached. Anyway, that's the good news I thought I'd share with you. I wonder when Karula is going to give birth next. Her last cubs that were known of were kind of December, January, early this year. So she's long overdue giving birth again. She sadly lost the final cub of that litter to a hyena. As you can see, the beautiful skyline continues this afternoon and has graced us with some incredible views. The entire safari from this moment we headed out until now, which is wonderful. It's not always about the animals, although you did get spoiled with some good sightings with James, less so on this vehicle, but just the scenery that we got to experience was quite marvelous, and a very pleasant afternoon to be out exploring. Oh, let's maybe stop here. There's a bolt of lightning that I just saw, and if Brian just zooms in a little bit straight more in there, that's where the last bolt was. So you're perfect there, Brian, I think. And let's hope another bolt comes down in the next few seconds before I say goodbye, or as I say my goodbyes, rather. Come on, one more big bolt of lightning. There's a little bit of lightning behind the clouds that you could see there. Okay, well, no luck with the lightning, but thank you very much for joining in on the safari, and we will see you tomorrow. Well, at least you will see Brent and Jamie out tomorrow morning. Over to James.
Ah, yes, well, you saw me very elegantly climbing to the top here so that I may be backlit by the beauty of the African sunset. Thank you, everybody, for a wonderful show, wonderful questions. So nice to have interactions like we have had with you. So please keep them coming like that. Big thank you to Andrew, back on camera, not drone commandering all over the place. Thanks to Nikki and Kirsty in the final control, and to Scott and Brian on the other vehicle. We will see you tomorrow, hopefully in the golden light of the African dawn. Bye-bye, and see you then.